Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello, everyone. I hope you've got your snacks ready because we got a pretty good story this evening. It comes from Joshua, and his encounter was in East Texas back in 1992. Now, this is a recollection from when he was a lot younger, but it's pretty interesting. So, okay, let's get started. Hello, Nance. I came across your videos on YouTube. I really enjoy listening to the stories from others that you share, and I wanted to share mine with you. I have passed my story along to Sasquatch Chronicles and the BFRO, both of which are listed on their site as well, some with a little more detail than others. I was going to be on the upcoming Bigfoot show that is coming out on the Travel Channel. However, due to my line of work and how scheduling works in TV production, I unfortunately had to decline and pass up that opportunity. I'm also a little concerned about criticism, especially in my line of work. You are more than welcome to reach back out, and I can give you my phone number and we can chat about this more if you want. I'm just going to say, folks, I have not had time to reach back out to Joshua. Last week, as you all know, I was pretty sick, but maybe I will. Maybe I'll see if I can get some more details from him. Okay, let me continue. My story is not for the faint of heart, as it does contain some rather graphic details. It is a rather terrifying, at least for me, and everything I write here is 100% the truth, and I will include as much detail as I possibly can to give the full entire picture. This happened around Thanksgiving in 1992. This is the most detailed amount of information I have ever provided to anyone regarding what went on our little farm. I grew up on a small, modest farm in East Texas. I was an only child and around 7 years old, and my mom tended to the horses and the other animals while my dad worked at the local paper mill. My father worked rotating shifts, and during this encounter, he was working the graveyard shift while my mom and I were home alone. We lived a few miles deep off of Highway 59 between Atlanta and Linden. At that time, the road was not paved and was just a regular dusty dirt road. There was a small creek that went under the road, and quite often it would flood and make the road impassable whenever it rained. Our yard would also become submerged underwater, and about a quarter mile down the road, water would sit and cause the area to become marshy and stagnant with old runoff water, sometimes for a couple of months. We had lots of animals on our little farm. We had horses, chickens, ducks, goats, cats, dog, and even pet quail that my grandmother gave me as she ran a quail farm on the outskirts of Domino and Queen City selling bobwhite quail. Behind our property and to the left side of the property at the time were two large pastures which a good friend of ours raised cattle on, and also had a pond to which my mom and I would go fishing. Now, we would usually catch brim and other small fish. Nothing was really ever able to be eaten, so we just spent time together fishing while enjoying the peace and quiet out there. We also had a small sunflower garden growing to the right of the side of the trailer, which was only about 15 feet away. Even though we lived in a trailer at the time, my mom spent a lot of time planting flowers in the front yard and making the place look like a cozy home. We also had rose bushes along the front side of the house and other thorny bushes that I don't know what they were called, but they sure would hurt if you ever accidentally brushed against one of them or fell into them. My father had built a deck at the front of the trailer, as the trailer sat roughly 3 feet off the ground, and the only way into our home was by getting in through the front door, through the deck, or through the back door, which had a metal staircase leading up to it. One night, my mom, dad, and myself got back from Thanksgiving dinner at my grandmother's house. My dad had to get ready to go to work, so it was just my mom and myself that were home alone. My mom pulled a mattress from the bedroom to the living room so we could watch movies together and just fall asleep together in the living room. I was just a little kid at the time. My mom and I were very close, and she was very protective of me. As most people do, I woke up in the early morning hours to go use the bathroom. I do remember looking at the clock, and it was between 1 and 2 a.m. in the morning, according to the VCR. I have had that habit my entire life, and to this day, it sometimes ruins me because if I wake up at 4 or 5, I am never able to go back to sleep. My mom ended up moving over to the sofa in front of the window to sleep, where the rose bushes were right on the other side of the window. It was really easy to look outside, even with the blinds closed, as they were very thin curtains that covered the window, which really didn't offer any privacy. The blinds were only partially closed. There was also a utility light outside that was always on, and you could see the shadows of the poles of the deck, the tree, and even rose bushes outside. However, the tree did not obscure the light, and the living room was quite bright because of it. On my way back from the bathroom, I had this sudden urge to look towards the window. I have no idea why I had that urge, but I did. What I saw, and even right now typing this out, I am getting chills. It was a huge man-like creature standing on our front deck. It was not a person. The silhouette of this human-like creature on our deck was massive. My father was 6'3" and roughly 250 pounds at the time. He was a big man and quite muscular, as his job was very labor-intensive. But whatever this was would have dwarfed my father. Just guessing at the height, it had to be at least 8 feet tall. It was not right up at the window, as the rose bushes were the thorny kind and they got quite big, but it was standing on the deck. I will never forget that particular type of fear that I felt. I froze instantly and fell down to the mattress. I was shaking, and I can only assume I passed out from the fear, because I remember very little about it. When I woke up, I thought what I had seen standing on our deck was nothing more than a bad dream. I brushed it off and went about my typical morning watching cartoons. Shortly after, my dad literally comes barging into the front door and is telling my mom, "Do not let him go outside. Keep him inside." But as any kid would do, I was asking why, and reluctantly, my mom and dad did let me go outside, and what I saw made my stomach sink. There were dead animals all over our front and backyard. In the dirt road out in the front of our property, there were piles of duck feathers. There were actually several piles all around our property. We walked around the yard, and going into the barn, I saw a lot of baby ducks that I had been raising that were now dead with their necks broken. No bite marks at all. I also found one of my pygmy chicken's heads was ripped from its body and found about 15 feet away. All of the quail were gone, which were in a cage about 5 feet off the ground. There were roughly 5 to 6 quail that we had as pets, mostly for me. These quail were fully white in color, and one even had a solid horn growing out of the front of its head. I thought that particular bird was pretty cool. I barely could reach the cage any other time, so I am not sure what could have gotten up that high to get them out of the cage, and surprisingly, there were no feathers around the cage either. Now, several days later, we did find one duck that had survived, and we tried to protect it the best we could. We fortified a cage outdoors and made it as strong as possible. But one day, it simply vanished. Being a little kid, I was in tears and bawling my eyes out. I grew very attached to many of the animals that we had on our farm, and I actually hatched those baby ducks myself with a heat lamp in my bedroom because ants were trying to get into the eggs while they were hatching a few months earlier. so seeing them all dead ripped me apart. Now, our neighbors had come up from down the road. My father was actually arguing with one of them, accusing him that his dogs came on our property and killed our ducks and chickens. Not all of the chickens were gone, but all the ducks and quail were. The horses were fine, and so were some of the other animals. It seems whatever attacked our animals went specifically for the birds. The chickens were in a cage, and the ducks were free range and wandered about at their own free will. In the pasture behind our home, this was the most terrifying of all that we encountered in the upcoming days. A day or so had passed, and my mom and I were heading to the pond, but there was a cow that was dead. Its eyes were still open, and the tongue was hanging out with a long incision down the cow's stomach, with all of the intestines and organs removed. There was not much blood around either, which I thought was strange, and shortly after, my mom and I went back to our trailer. What felt really strange was that the incision seemed to be more clean-cut than what a mountain lion or panther would inflict on its prey. There were absolutely no claw marks on the animal that we could see, just the long slit down this cow's stomach. We definitely did have panthers that roamed around the area. I know, as one day I saw a black panther running across the road, and it jumped up into a pine tree, roughly 7+ feet high. Behind the panther was our hybrid wolf that was nearly a full-blooded Mackenzie Valley wolf. It was chasing it across the yard. We had bears, too, as one day I saw a small black-colored cub attempting to cross over into our horse pen. But when it saw me, it took off down the side of the pen and ran away on all fours, so it was actually a bear. We had lots of wild animals that roamed the region. My father ended up saying it must have been a weasel or maybe a crazy person that had done all of this. There was a home for troubled boys several miles down the road, deep into the woods, and my dad thought maybe one of them did it. Shortly after, my mom kept a shotgun by the front door and stayed on guard at all times. My dad would joke about it being a Bigfoot, but did not really believe at the time, or so he said. More on that later. Before this incident had happened, we had to give away our hybrid wolf because our neighbor with the cows thought that our wolf was killing off his calves. But at that time, we kept her on a chain while his cattle were going missing. But to prevent legal issues, we got rid of her. Now, this was before the creature showed up. We never saw the creature again after this, but often heard strange sounds outside. My parents split up and eventually sold off the property about 3 years later. I had a talk with my mom in regards to what I had seen that night, and she told me something I did not even remember. She told me that I told her that night that I was coming back from the bathroom that something was standing on our front deck, and she had told me to get down and don't move. That I do not remember. But she clearly does. She said she was terrified as well, and she saw the shadow of this thing as it was blocking some of the light coming into the living room. So she clearly saw something that was there too, but she didn't look out the window at it specifically. Now, later in life, this incident has come up a lot in our discussions, and I had asked her had she ever seen anything. She said no. But she would hear blood-curdling screams coming from our neighbor's barn about a quarter mile away. She said it sounded like a woman being murdered, and then one night she was out by the barn with the horses and said she heard a growl that was very deep and guttural, and she slowly backed away and came into the house with me. She was always protective most over me, more than anything else out there. I would always play in the woods in the yard. I was a typical country boy who was not ever really afraid. Only after that incident, I am actually more nervous to go wandering off in the forest now than I ever have been. I do remember a few times when I would want to go fishing alone at that pond, and I would have this gut feeling that would make me freeze in my steps, and something internal told me not to go, and I was halfway between the trailer and the pond. I turned around and ran home. That was the last time I ever went to that pond. I moved with my dad shortly after. I never really chalked this up to being a Bigfoot until later in my life. I always had a fascination with Bigfoot and was reading stories for Cass County on the BFRO website, and right down the road, a truck driver reported seeing a Sasquatch run across the road close to a rest area. This rest area literally was close to the entrance of the road that was used about a half mile away to get to our home and others in the area. At that moment, I put two and two together, and I was thinking, that is what that was. I also heard, too, from others, that Sasquatches do have a tendency to take cattle and other farm animals. That makes a bit more sense, as something had taken our quail, which was up 5 feet off the ground, and I don't know how a weasel or even a mountain lion could get up that high to find the latch and open the cage. Others around the East Texas region had many encounters as well, and a neighbor down the road that my mom was good friends with at the time had a relative over. She was a super religious woman that would not tolerate lying or any nonsense whatsoever. But she told us of a story where her father was riding a donkey coming home one night down in Avenger, Texas, and something knocked him off his donkey and took a swipe at it and left claw marks on the back of the donkey. He ended up running the rest of the way home. She said he claimed it was a Bigfoot that had done that. I only bring this up due to her nonsense approach to most matters. She would not tell a story like that to just scare someone. Also, back to my father not believing in Bigfoot. Many years had passed. He quit working at the paper mill and opened his own logging company. When I was having a conversation with him earlier this year regarding going on that TV show for the Travel Channel, he said he believes they exist. I was asking him why did he change his mind. He said, one day he was up in Arkansas clear-cutting some timber for a client, and he saw one walking along the edge of the woods, and he said, I'll be damned. And sure enough, he saw one right before his eyes. He did not account for much detail, but saw it good enough to clearly know what it was. I no longer live in Texas, and now reside in the Denver area. I still love the outdoors and go camping sometimes up in the mountains, but I keep on alert because even up there, we hear things at night, and we do remote camping, and one night we heard something walking around on 2 feet, not four, and I was praying that it went away because I was not ready to handle another encounter. The next day, we left that area. It was way up in the mountains close to Mount Evans and only accessible with a 4x4 off-road vehicle. Also heard something making owl-like sounds close to Mount Evans as well, and it was not an owl, to say the very least. It sounded like a person making hoot-like sounds. It was about 4 p.m. in the afternoon, and to the side of the hiking trail, there was actually what looked like someone walked down from the deep woods, stopped, and turned back. I didn't see anyone or anything. The snow was pushed aside like someone was walking in deep snow trekking across the area. However, no tracks were seen going from the trail to that area where someone would need to walk off the trail to go pee and then come back. This was coming from the forest to the edge of the trail, then back into the forest, if that makes sense. Needless to say, we go prepared in case we ever run across one, but from what I suspect, nothing can ever really prepare you. Thank you for taking the time to read my encounter. I know this is quite a bit and every bit of it is true. You are welcome to call me and discuss this if you would ever like to. I sometimes wonder if it was out there where we lived, because it was mostly my mother and I that were running around on the property. I wanted to write this up and send it off to you, as I will be catching a flight tomorrow down to Texas to visit my mom and dad for an early Christmas. We actually are going to our old property together as a family to just reminisce over old times and talk about old happy memories. This is one of those things you will not ever forget. I know what I saw. My mom does too as well, and it is understandable to consider other creatures that could do the things that were done to our animals, but I cannot get over seeing that creature standing on our front deck. It was massive. The most terrifying part about this is, whatever it was standing on our deck, its body was directly facing towards where my mom and I were in the living room, as if it could see in through the blinds. It just stood there, without being right up to the window, which to this day is terrifying. I know that the size of this thing, a regular shotgun or rifle, could not take it down. People say they want to see one. Well, my suggestion is, if you do, you need a mighty powerful gun, like an elephant gun, or better yet, a tranquilizer gun with enough tranquilizer to knock this thing out. That's my encounter, and I hope it can help make others aware something is out there. Just keep your guard up and stay aware of your surroundings out in the woods. You never know what is really lurking out there and possibly watching you. All right, Joshua, thank you so much for sharing your memories about those encounters. I think if I had a memory of something like that standing outside looking in at me and my mom, I'd be pretty terrified too. I can appreciate that you've reported this to the BFRO, and thank you for giving us a detailed encounter. You know, I don't always get some that are so setting of the scene, and I really appreciate that, and I think my listeners did too. So, my Sasquatch, tell me what you think. Do you think that was a Sasquatch lurking around on that property? I really do think so. As always, tell me what you guys think in the comments down below. If you like what you've heard and want to hear more, click the like and subscribe button, and don't forget the bell to get notifications. Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, drop me a line at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com and tell me all about it. Then I'll share it with everyone. All right, everyone, that wraps up tonight's encounter. Be sure to tune in starting this Friday. We're going to kick off the 12 days of Squatchmas. And if you haven't already, be sure to hop over to the website at www.buckeyebigfoot.com and make sure you're registered for the giveaways, because, you know, it's Squatchmas, and I'm feeling like giving away a couple extra things this year. So be sure to tune in this Friday, and until then, I am Nance Warren, and I'll be putting the sass into Sasquatch. And you guys are the Sasquad. You guys are out there scaring up all the evidence on the King of the Forest. And I know when you get it, you send it on in. All right, everyone. Have a great night, and thanks for listening.